shame is a prison as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber and he's come to take my name. Oh, love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. War between death and life, and there on the tree, the Lamb of God was crucified, and he went on down to hell, and he took back every key. He rose up as a lion, and he set the captives free. Said there ain't no grave could hold our body down. There ain't no grave could hold his body down. When he heard that trumpet sound, he rose up out the ground. Oh, there ain't no grave could hold his body. Don't you listen to this next part. If you walk out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walk out of the grave, I'm walking too. Oh, if you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. Oh, if you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. Come on.
Hold my body down.
so much God.
Who was that babe born in Bethlehem? They laid him in a manger. There was no room in the inn. He was born of a virgin. He was God's only son. The angels shouted in the night that Christ had come.
Who was that man?
Man of Galilee.
Who made the lame to walk
and caused the blind to see?
He cleansed the spotted leper.
He spoke with authority. He broke the chains of sin and set the captives free.
He was so much man that he
slept in a boat.
He was so much God
that the wind ceased when he spoke.
He was so much man that he wept when Lazarus died.
Yet he was so much God, Lazarus came forth
when he cried.
He was so much man
that he thirsted at the well.
He was so much God
that he freed her soul from hell.
He was so much man
that he died upon a tree. He was so much God that he rose in victory.
Who was that man crying from the tree? Father, forgive them for what they've done to me. They placed him in a borrowed tomb. The stone held fast the door.
He rose up from the grave. Now he lives forevermore.
He was so much man that he
slept in a boat.
He was so much God
that the wind ceased when he spoke.
He was so much man that he wept when Lazarus died.
Yet he was so much God, Lazarus came forth
when he cried.
He was so much man
that he thirsted at the well.
He was so much God
that he freed her soul from hell.
He was so much man
that he died upon a tree. He was so much God. He was so much man.
He was so much man that he
slept in a boat.
He was so much God
that the wind ceased when he spoke.
He was so much man that he wept when Lazarus died.
Yet he was so much God, Lazarus came forth
when he cried.
He was so much man
that he thirsted at the well.
He was so much God
that he freed her soul from hell.
He was so much man
that he died upon a tree. He was so much God. He was so much man. He was so much God that he rose in victory.
Amen.
Drive the nails in my hands. Laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say it isn't me. The days will come when you will see. 'Cause I'll death can't keep me in mock my name. My love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free. 'Cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead and try to hide the sun, but all will see that he's the one. Draws near, Solid Rock Assembly.
Amen.
Theologian one time by the name of C.T. Studd said, if Christ be God and died for me, there's nothing that is too hard for me to do for him. Amen. Let that sink in. But you know, today there's people sitting in here and watching by YouTube, Facebook, listening by radio, I don't know, that maybe you haven't lived that way. And it's okay to be honest about that. Maybe you are sitting here today thinking, boy, I've really messed up bad. And I don't know how God will ever forgive me or use me or do anything with me. I don't even know why I'm here. Maybe you feel like that, but you won't say it out loud. Well, that same situation happened to the Apostle Peter in Mark chapter 14. Jesus had been arrested for nothing more than doing good. And he was on trial, an illegal trial, by the way, which was held against him. And Peter showed up from outside of the place where they were trying our Lord, and he was just watching what was going on. And in verse 66, it says, as Peter was beneath in the palace, there come one of the maids of the high priest. And when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked upon him and said, and you also was with Jesus of Nazareth. Maybe you've done this. But he denied, saying, I know not, neither understand what you're saying. The modern word for that is, I don't know what you're talking about. How many times have we done that when we were confronted with our sin? And he went out into the porch and the rooster crowed. And he denied it again. And a little later, they that stood by said again to Peter, surely you're one of them, for you're a Galilean, and your speech agreeth thereto. In other words, you sound like you're from Hogtown. You're part of Solid Rock. I can tell by listening to you talk. Peter was more in fear of his own life and his own well-being than that of what happened to the Lord. And it said he began to curse and to swear, saying, I know not this man of whom you speak of. And the second time the rooster crowed, and Peter remembered that Jesus said unto him, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. And when he thought thereon, he wept. And one of the Gospels said that he wept bitterly. Maybe you haven't openly denied Christ by cursing and swearing, but let's just get honest. Maybe you've denied him with your lifestyle. Maybe you have shunned the worship of the Lord to the point to where it's just plumb embarrassing. Nobody would ever know that you knew Jesus by the way you live, by the way you behave. And that's something to really think hard about. There are a lot of ways we have denied Christ. Our fear, our doubt, what we do. Think about that. But I also want you to know, and I thank God for it, God is a God of the second chance.
Yes.
My mother looked at me and said, you need to thank God that he's the God of the 10,000th chance. I'm not sure what she meant by that, but I have some idea. But I also want you to know there isn't a single person in here today that's in here by accident or chance. God wanted you to be here.
Amen.
We have no idea what he went through to get us saved. The suffering that he went through was beyond. He said he was even marred more than any man was ever marred, so that nobody could even recognize him as a human being when they looked at him. And he did that for me, and he did that for you.
Amen.
Your salvation is free, but doggone it, we owe him everything we have and everything we are. We owe him. We will never be able to repay him, but we can give him all of what we are. How could we do any less with what he did for us? He made salvation so easy that a little kid can receive it and understand it. And it didn't cost you or me anything. It cost him everything. Everything he had. We owe him. How can we not serve him with all of our heart, knowing what he did? And so maybe this morning you have thrown a shoe in the race of life, and you've been sidelined, and you've been a spectator only. And you're thinking, you know, that's pretty bad. I feel really bad about the way I have lived. Would God even want me anymore? When Peter did what he did, he knew he blew it. And he stepped aside as one of the apostles of Christ, to the point that even the angels knew what he had done. But let me show you what forgiveness and restoration looks like. Because maybe you are here this morning and you need some restoration and you need some forgiveness. Chapter 16 of Mark, when the Sabbath was passed, Jesus had been buried and put in a tomb with a huge stone door rolled across it. And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint Jesus. And very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came unto the tomb at the rising of the sun. When they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the tomb? They went not even knowing how they were going to get in there. It had been sealed by the Roman government. And a group of soldiers had been assigned there to guard it. And you can read that in one of the other gospels about what that looked like and what happened. When they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away already, for it was very great. First of all, I want everybody in here to understand that no matter what sin you have, no matter what you have done, no matter what you feel right now, I want you to understand that the stone has already been rolled away for you.
That's right.
It already has. No matter how heavy that stone is, it has been rolled away for you. And entering into the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted, as it says. That literally means amazed. It was an angel waiting on them when they got in the tomb. And he said unto them, "Be not affrighted. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, look at the place where they laid him." They said that the napkin that covered his face had been folded up in such a manner as to say, "I'm not done yet. I'll be back." But that's another story. Let's focus on Peter. He had cursed and swore and declared that he did not know Jesus when he had traveled with him and performed miracles with him and seen it all for 3 years. And now he was done. It looked like his life was over. His ministry was over. And there he was, weeping bitterly because of what he had said and what he had done. Maybe that is you this morning. Maybe I'm talking to you. I don't know who everybody is in here, and if I do, I don't know your heart. But listen to what this angel said. "Go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There you shall see him, as he said unto you." And they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 demons. I want you to understand, Jesus loves you. Even if he had to cast 7 demons out of you, you are still welcome. If you've got 7 demons in you this morning, you are still welcome. The Lord will cast them out. But let's not forget Peter. Even though Peter thought everything was over for him, he got included. The churches may shut you out. This one better not. Not long as I'm here. Churches may shut you out. Fellow Christians, and I use that word loosely, may shut you out. The world may shut you out. It doesn't make any difference. I want you to know that the Lord still wants to include you and put you back on your feet and restore you and let you serve him. Peter wound up being the most powerful of all of the disciples when he got right with God and got forgiven. Matter of fact, he denied Jesus 3 times. And when he and Peter sat once again to eat, Jesus said 3 times, "Peter, do you love me?" And he confessed him 3 times. What does that tell me? All you need to do this morning for the Lord to put you back on your feet is to ask his forgiveness and confess him as your Lord. And he'll do it. Peter led thousands of people to the Lord on the day of Pentecost with just one short sermon. It was a different Peter this time. This was not a cowardly Peter, not a fearful Peter, not a Peter who had messed up, but one who was full of the Holy Spirit. God will do that for you if you will let Him. I want you to understand that Easter Sunday is a day of resurrection. A lot of people wonder, why did Jesus pick Easter? Because it was an older pagan celebration at one time. Why did He pick that to rise from the dead? Because the original pagan celebration of Easter was to celebrate fertility and life. That's why they used, there's nothing more fertile than a rabbit. And they used an egg because that represents life. That's why they do that. But Jesus chose that day to rise from the dead to show that He alone has life.
That's right.
That He alone is life. And that He has power and Him alone over life itself. To show that there is no other God, no other entity but Him. And so this morning, the invitation is very simple. If you need restoration, I can't think of a better place than the altar at Solid Rock Baptist Church to get it. The Lord is waiting for you to accept forgiveness from Him and to accept restoration from Him. If you have never